Hello everyone, this is the second video on Marcel Junoud's Warriors Without Weapons, the extract which you have got to study, the first atom bomb. The extract is actually taken from this particular book by Marcel Junoud, Warriors Without Weapons. And in this video, I would like to talk in detail about the extract that has been taken from this particular book, which is titled The First Atom Bomb. Dr. Marcel Junoud, as I told you in the previous video, he was the head of the ICRC's delegation in Japan. And he arrived there at Tokyo on August 9th, 1945, the very day that the United States had dropped a second atomic bomb, this time on Nagasaki. Junoud, who had been traveling for almost 2 months, was quite unaware of what was happening in Japan, the situation in Japan there. His mission in visiting Japan was actually to visit the prisoners of war there who were held in Japan and to extend help for them according to international rules and regulations. It was after reaching Tokyo that Junoud got the details of the bombings in Hiroshima and the extent of the devastation and the loss and the trauma that the people of Japan was going through lots and lots of photographs. And within no time, Junoud set his wheels on for a belated but still important effort in easing the pain of the people in Hiroshima. It was on September 8th that he flew from Tokyo with members of an American technical commission and a consignment of relief provided by the US Armed Forces. Junoud, in his Warriors Without Weapons, talks about the moment when he flew over Hiroshima. He says, I quote, "At 12 o'clock we flew over Hiroshima. We witnessed a sight totally unlike anything we had ever seen before. The center of the city was a sort of white patch, flattened and smooth like the palm of a hand. Nothing remained. The slightest trace of houses seemed to have disappeared completely. The white patch was almost about 2 kilometers in diameter. Around its edge was a red belt marking the area where houses had burned, extending quite a long way further, difficult to judge from the airplane, covering almost all the rest of the city. It was an awesome sight," unquote. This is what Junoud himself talks about, the condition of Hiroshima when he was flying over Hiroshima. The extract that you have got to study, that is the first atom bomb, opens when Junoud narrates about the lack of information that he and his crew had when he reached Japan about the devastation that had already occurred in Japan. He just got the news of it and the details of it just after 3 weeks. Even after 3 weeks, he did not get a complete picture of what was happening there in Japan. Of course, news was there about the preparations of the use of the new weapon and about the extraordinary power that this new weapon carried, but there was no news, of course, about the effects of this blast on the people, except that the explosion would prevent all forms of lives in the city for almost 70 years. Each and every American that he saw in Japan, in Tokyo, and even the Japanese people were remaining completely silent, or they were maintaining a sort of silence about the whole incident. news about the explosion and the catastrophe, he afterwards got it. He got about the news and about the catastrophe that was surrounding he got it when it was transmitted from mouth to mouth, and it was this way. It was orally that through verbal transmission that Marcel Junod got at least a vague idea of what had happened in Japan. He talks about one of their secretaries, Nohara, who is actually half Japanese, and he told him that many people had fled from Hiroshima so that they could be safe with their families. Now, the first-hand description about the horror that Junod got to know was really drastic in every way. She was actually talking about, Nohara was talking about, Nohara and the first-hand descriptions that he got from various people, they were actually talking about a blinding light which suddenly flashed out of a peaceful sky, which was a horrible sight for everybody to witness. Even the details of the death that Junod got to know, about the people who died, about the killings, etc., that was very much vague. Some people said that it was almost 50,000 people who died. Some others said that it was almost 2 lakh people. So the first thing, or the at the very moment, or even after 3 weeks, the news about the whole thing was not circulated that much, or Marcel Junod and his crew couldn't get ample details about what was happening in Japan, even when they were in Tokyo, right? So this extract about the Hiroshima attack, it talks about the first atom bomb, the extract that we are talking about. It deals with the life in Hiroshima before the bombings, like what Hiroshima was like before the bombings occurred. And how it also talks about how a whole city, a city which was filled with life, got obliterated with no life at all, no life and no non-life at all after the bombing. It was on 2nd of September that Junod got a letter from Bilfinger, which gave him almost a very factual account, but the account was factual but disjointed account of the devastation. I'll just read it out. It goes like this: situation horrifying, 90% of town razed, all hospitals destroyed or severely damaged. Have visited 2 provisional hospitals, conditions indescribable, bomb effects mysterious, many victims apparently recovering suddenly experience a fatal relapse owing to degeneration of white corpuscles and other internal injuries, deaths still occurring in great numbers, more than 1 lakh victims still in provisional hospitals in neighborhood, grave shortage of material, bandages, medicaments, appeal allied high command supplies to be parachuted immediately into center of the town, urgently need large supplies of bandages, cotton wool, ointments for burns, sulfamides, blood plasma, transfusion kits, immediate action necessary. So this was the letter that he got from Bilfinger, which gave somewhat of an idea about what was happening there in Hiroshima. What he did after reading this telegram from Bilfinger, he took this telegram and the photographs that he had in his possession about the blast, which he got recently, to the Yokohama Chamber of Commerce, to General MacArthur and his officers. The officers comprised of General Fitch, who is the chief of the US Information Service, Colonel Marcus, who is in charge of the Prisoners of the War Department, Colonel Webster, who is the chief of the Hospital Service, and Colonel Sams, who was in charge of the Assistance for Civil Population. Now, he went there and he had much of a debate there. After having enough debates and discussions on this matter, at last it was after 5 days, that is on September 7th, that Colonel Sams called him, summoned him to Yokohama and informed him that U.S. Army cannot organize a direct relief. But then General MacArthur had promised that he is ready to provide almost 15 tons of medicaments and hospital materials, which Junood could distribute under the control and responsibility of the Red Cross. So on September 9th, a boat took Marcel Junood and his crew to Hiroshima, where a car was waiting for them with two Japanese interpreters. One was Miss Ito and one was another Japanese journalist. Now, from these interpreters, from Miss Ito and from the other Japanese journalist, Marcel Junood gets to know about the past life of Hiroshima. Hiroshima, the word itself means the broad island. It was before the bombings, it was a city like any other city, brimming with life, a very busy, prosperous city, a city which is built on the delta of the river Ota, which flows from the Mount Kemuri. And it was the seventh biggest town in the whole of Japan. Hiroshima was a city which was filled with factories, arsenal, oil refineries, warehouses, like any other city, right? It was a city which is filled with liveliness. It was filled with vibrancy of the people there. And this particular city had a population of almost 250,000 people plus 150,000 soldiers. Now, as Junood was moving around the blighted city, he was piecing together what had happened to Hiroshima on the 6th of August 1945 from various first-hand accounts, including the account that the journalist gave about the bombings. He said that there was no cloud in the sky. A small wind blew from the south. An air raid warning came at 7:09 in the morning. Four American B-29 planes appeared. Now, two of these planes passed on from north and moved to south and disappeared in the direction of the Shoho Sea. Other two flew southwards in the direction of the Bingo Sea. At 7:30, everything was okay. Everything was clear. People came out. They overcame their fear and they just came out and began to do their routine works. They began to get engaged in their own affairs, their daily activities. Then suddenly what happened was that a glaring whitish pinkish light appeared in the sky with a sort of a natural tremor, with a wave of suffocating heat. Everything was over by then. The place, after that moment, the place where stood a city so vibrant with life got completely scattered into pieces, got completely turned out to ashes, to debris, to a sort of a wasteland. I would just read out some lines from this. Within a few seconds, the thousands of people in the streets and the gardens in the center of the town were scorched by a wave of searing heat. Many were killed instantly. Others lay writhing on the ground, screaming in agony from the intolerable pain of their burns. Everything standing upright in the way of the blast, walls, houses, factories, and other buildings was annihilated, and the debris spun around in a whirlwind and was carried up into the air. Trams were picked up and tossed aside as though they had neither weight nor solidity. Trains were flung off the rails as though they were toys. Horses, dogs, and cattle suffered the same fate as human beings. Every living thing was petrified in an attitude of indescribable suffering. Even the vegetation did not escape. Trees went up in flames. The rice plants lost their greenness. The grass burned on the ground like dry straw. Russell Junod says in this particular book, in Warriors Without Weapons, that the first signs of these effects were visible almost for 4 or 5 miles from the bomb's dropping point. The roofs looked so denuded. The tiles over the houses had been blown off by the blast, and in places the grass had turned out to be bleached, dried, blackened. The whole of the vegetation for almost all of that, the place, all over the place, from the bomb's epicenter, like miles and miles surrounding the bomb's epicenter, had lost their coloring, the green color, immediately after the explosion. Even as far as some plants are concerned, they got back their greenery, not in the full way, not in a complete sense, but then somewhat they got back their greenery after 4 or 5 weeks. But then there were some other plants which was so very sensitive. Obviously, it was very sensitive, and they died all of a sudden. And see, almost everything that you can see in a city, the plants, the animals, the people around there, their routine life, the cities, the buildings, the effort or the effort that people had taken to brick by brick, they had actually built a whole life of their own there in that particular city. They considered it as their home, and their home, their whole refuge, their whole shelter died out in a moment. It was blasted. It was something man had done against men. It was something man had used his own power against his own fellow human beings. And the whole of the city got blasted within a moment, as a result of which life changed for the Hiroshima people in a fraction of a second. There was, of course, after almost half an hour later, there was a small rain. It happens because of the heat and all. There was a small rain. By the evening, what happened was that the whole city had died out. There was nothing left there. Nothing was left to burn. Everything had turned to ashes. Everything, every life, everything changed in a day. Everything got disappeared within a fraction of a second. Now he details on his visit to this particular place, that is Hiroshima. When he visited a ruined station in Hiroshima, he saw that the hands of the clock had stopped at this historic moment, that is 8:15. Elsewhere, he describes this moment, this time, 8:15 a.m. He says, at about 8:15 a.m., when the inhabitants were going to work, a sudden blinding light, pink and white, appeared in the sky. This was accompanied by a sort of shudder, followed almost immediately by a suffocating heat and a blast wave sweeping away everything in its path. And now Marcel Junod and the crew, they were walking around this dead city. The city which was once so alive has transformed itself into a dead city, a city which was so vibrant with all kinds of the hubbub that you would see in a city, was suddenly transformed into a city filled with a sort of a ghostly silence looming around. They couldn't, Marcel Junod and the crew couldn't even find a single survivor in the form of human or animal or bird. Now he talks about Professor Suzuki, who actually in disjointed words, you cannot, when you are so very filled with emotion, when you are seeing things completely shattered around you, when you do not see life brimming, when you do not when you see everything dead around you and you're so very filled with emotion, what happens is you cannot utter sentences, you cannot complete sentences would not come out. So Suzuki, Professor Suzuki, who was a Japanese professor, he actually in a very disjointed sentences, he utters that we must, I quote, we must all open our minds and try to understand everything. He says that instead of a hospital with 200 beds, 8 doctors, 20 nurses and enough patients, here is nothing now. Nothing remains now, just remnants of the wall. This is what atomic bomb does to you. Afterwards, of course, after visiting Hiroshima, Junood and his crew, they took up lots and lots of relief operations to bring out the victims back to life, most of the victims back to life, and also to he also helped them to overcome the wounds and the trauma that was left behind. Junood later on, somewhere in Warriors Without Weapons, says that he checks on the situation in hospitals. What was the situation? What is the condition of the hospitals there? And he says that they do not have a permanent hospital for the victims, to take care of the victims, the victims of the bombings. Instead, all the hospitals they had were makeshift places. They were quite temporary ones. One of the hospital he talks about is an emergency hospital, which is in a half demolished school. A school is being transformed, a half demolished school is being transformed into a hospital, and there are many holes in the on the roof of the school. And what happens is, on the day he visited there, it was raining and the water was dripping into the patient's room. Those who had strength, those patients who did have the strength to wake up from there and move to sheltered corners, moved to those places where it was not raining. Some people who did have the strength, they just huddled into some sheltered corners, while other patients who couldn't actually move, they lay there. They lay on some kind of pallets, and they were dying each and every moment. They were moving on and on towards death. And he's talking about there was, in that particular hospital itself, there was 84 sick and injured, and only 10 nurses and 20 schoolgirls to take care of them. Schoolgirls, see, very little girls who had the age, who were actually aged from 12 to 15 years of age to look after them. Just 10 nurses and 20 schoolgirls to look after all these 84 of the sick people. And about the facilities in that hospital was quite pathetic, in the sense that they had no water, no sanitary installations, and no kitchen at all. Now he talks about the treatment there in that kinds of hospitals. He says that a doctor comes in from outside to visit the sick every day, and the medical care there is very rudimentary. The dressings that you usually do on the wounds are made of coarse clothing. There are a few jars of medicines lying around on the shelf, and most of the time what happens is the injured do have uncovered wounds, and flies would be settling on them, buzzing around. Everything there in that particular hospital is incredibly filthy. And several patients are suffering from delayed effects of radioactivity, and there are multiple hemorrhages for them. And most of the people, because of this hemorrhages, they needed blood transfusions at regular intervals. But the problem is that there won't be any donors there, and no doctors would be there to determine the compatibility of the blood group. In short, you can say that was a very pathetic condition where treatment, the basic necessity, was not being met. Now, at the end of this extract, Marcel Junood is talking about the moment before he leaves Tokyo. the moment when General MacArthur thanked him for the work that he had done, for the relief operations that he had done, for the assistance, the support that he had provided to each and every life, each and every victim of the Hiroshima bomb blast, he said, I quote, "The supreme value of human life and human blood had been forgotten by the war, and human dignity too." And he goes on, "Force is not a solution for man's problems. Force on its own is nothing. It never has the last word. Even with our present weapons, not including those still to be developed, a new war would leave nothing behind worthy of mention." Now, this extract, this extract.